Einen schönen guten Abend und herzlich willkommen hier im Kino des Deutschen Filmmuseums zu unserer Reihe Lecture and Film. In diesem Jahr oder seit letztem Oktober geht es um Agnes Wahler, Selbstporträts von anderen. Den meisten erzähle ich sehr viel Bekanntes dabei. Das, was heute anders ist als sonst, das ist, dass wir tatsächlich heute mal einen 35mm Film zeigen werden. Das ist nur mit dem Applaus warten. Das ist der einzige Film, der noch nicht restauriert worden ist von Agnes Wahler, weswegen er noch nicht digital vorliegt. Und das ist besonders kurios, weil er gleichzeitig der erste Film war, den sie digital gedreht hat auf Mini-DV. Das nur schon mal als kleiner Hinweis vorweg, aber Sonja wird vielleicht danach auch noch drauf eingehen. Worauf ich auch noch eingehen möchte, ist natürlich, das ist ein perfekter Zeitpunkt für Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, denn wir haben in dieser Woche, wie Sie vielleicht mitbekommen haben, unsere Sonderausstellung abgebaut, zusammen sammeln. Da ging es um das Sammeln und das heute ist der Inbegriff des Sammelns im Film bei Agnes Wahler und vielleicht generell in der Filmgeschichte. Insofern für uns auch ein schöner Schlusspunkt zu unserer Ausstellung, die jetzt eben, die Sie hoffentlich besucht haben, auch in dem Zusammenhang. Ich freue mich sehr, dass die Reihe noch weitergeht bis in den Juli. Wie immer mit unseren tollen Partnern, auch von der Goethe-Universität. Heute kommt auch unsere Rednerin von der Goethe-Universität und vorgestellt wird sie jetzt von Vinzenz Hediger. Ich wünsche Ihnen einen schönen Abend.
Ja, guten Abend und herzlich willkommen zu dieser Alternativveranstaltung zur Bundesliga-Relegation. Werden natürlich über die Zwischenresultate informieren. Als Titel dieser Reihe dient uns ein Zitat aus dem Film Jane Biebach, Agnès W. von 1988. Das Porträt, das Wahler von Jane Birkin dreht, sei wie ein Selbstporträt einer anderen. Man kann aus diesem Zitat, wie wir das mit dieser Reihe zu tun versuchen, durchaus eine Poetik des Werks von Agnès Wahler ableiten. Und die Filme, die wir nun seit Oktober gemeinsam gesehen und besprochen haben, lösen diese Programmansage durchaus ein. Wenn man der Reihe aber einen anderen Titel hätte geben wollen, der ebenfalls aus dem Werk von Wahler selbst stammt und als eine Art programmatische Ansage zur Poetik von Wahler gelten kann, dann hätte man den Titel des Films nehmen können oder müssen, um den es heute Abend gehen wird, der Die Ehrenleser und die Ehrenleserin lautet die korrekte deutsche Übersetzung. Sonja wird uns gleich erklären, worum es dabei geht. In einem weiteren Sinne bedeutet der Titel die Sammler und die Sammlerin, vielleicht auch die Lumpensammler und die Lumpensammlerin. Die Glaneurs, diese Sammler, Ehrensammler, Lumpensammler, sind Menschen, die vom Auflesen von Übriggebliebenen, von Abfällen, von Resten leben. Sie sind marginale Gestalten in unseren modernen, stets auf das Neue und den Konsum fokussierten Gesellschaften. Sie sind randständig und kaum wahrgenommen. Es gehört nun aber gerade zu den Eigenheiten von Wahlers Werk, dass sie ihren Blick immer wieder auf Dinge und Menschen richtet, die sonst kaum, ja nie die Aufmerksamkeit auf sich ziehen. Die alten Menschen in L'Opéra Mouffe, zum Beispiel dem vom Surrealismus inspirierten Kurzfilm, den wir an den letzten beiden Abenden in der Reihe gesehen und dann auch besprochen haben und in dem ein guter Teil der Aufmerksamkeit den alten Menschen in der Straße gilt. Könnte auch die Steinskulpturen nackter Frauenfiguren, die Pariser Fassaden zieren und ebenfalls kaum je beachtet werden, unter diesem Gesichtspunkt anschauen, aus dem sehr schönen Film L'Edith Cariatide. Die Glaneurs zählen ebenfalls zu diesen marginalen Figuren und es gehört eben zu den Eigenheiten in Wahlers Werk, dass sie den unsichtbaren Marginalen begegnet, aber eben nicht mit einem Pathos des Miserabilismus, mit dem sie ihnen gönnerhaft zu einer Stimme oder zu einem Bild, zu einer Repräsentation verhelfen würde. Vielmehr erkennt sich Wahler in gewisser Weise in ihnen wieder, Selbstporträts in anderen, und genau daran liegt eben das Poetische und Pragmatische dieses Titels. Sie interessiert sich für diese Sammler, weil diese im Grunde genau das machen, was sie in der Kunst auch macht, die Dinge aufsammeln, für die sich sonst nur wenige interessieren und in denen dann doch die ganze Welt aufbewahrt ist. Unsere Rednerin hat für diese Poetik ohne Frage ein besonderes Verständnis, insofern ihr Arbeitsfeld das Archiv ist. Und da nicht die großen kanonischen Werke, sondern Werke, Arbeiten, Filme, Dinge, für die sich vor ihr kaum jemand interessierte, von denen sich aber gerade durch die Aufmerksamkeit, die ihnen da zuteil wird, zeigt, dass sie einen ganz neuen Schlüssel zur Filmgeschichte enthalten. Sonia Campanini studierte an der Università Cattolica, der Freien Universität Berlin und der Universität Bologna Filmwissenschaft mit einem Schwerpunkt im Bereich Filmarchivierung und Restaurierung. Sie realisierte danach an der Deutschen Kinemathek in Berlin Filmrestaurierungen, unter anderem, und das ist eben eine von diesen Trouvaillen, Marginalien, die dadurch eine ganz andere Sichtweise der Filmgeschichte erlauben, dass sie aufgefunden und restauriert wurden. Sie war beschäftigt mit der Restaurierung von Tonbildfilmen, die mit dem Biophon-System zwischen 1904 und 1909 realisiert wurden und damit zu den ältesten Tonfilmen der Filmgeschichte gehörte. Sie arbeitete an anderen Projekten im Österreichischen Filmmuseum und am UCLA Archive in Los Angeles und wurde schließlich promoviert an der Universität Amsterdam mit einer Arbeit, die sie am Netherlands Film Institute, am EI, durchgeführt hatte im Jahr 2014, eine grundlegende Arbeit über Theorie und Praxis der Restaurierung des Filmtons. Und diese Arbeit wird demnächst im Übrigen auch als Band in der Reihe Framing Film bei Amsterdam University Press erscheinen. Seit April 2015 ist Sonia Campanini Juniorprofessorin auf der im Zusammenhang mit der Einrichtung des Studiengangs Filmkultur, Archivierung, Programmierung und Präsentation, den wir von der Universität gemeinsam mit dem Deutschen Filminstitut anbieten, im Zuge dieser Einrichtung dieses Studiengangs neu geschaffenen Professur. Da ist Sonia Campanini eben seit 2015 tätig. Begrüßen Sie bitte gemeinsam mit mir Sonia Campanini.
Yeah, thank you, Vincent, for this nice and generous presentation. Thank you, Vincent, Mark, and Urs for organizing this wonderful expedition in the work and world of Agnès Varda and for inviting me tonight. And thank you all for being here tonight despite the football game. It is my pleasure to introduce you the film Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, a documentary directed by Agnès Varda in 2000. In this presentation, my purpose is to describe Agnès Varda as a gleaner of images and sounds. I will start by considering how gleaners are defined and represented in the film. Then I'll focus on the gleaner Agnès Varda and discuss the act of gleaning as a metaphor for her cinematographic attitude, style, and poetic. I will refer to previous films, L'Opéra Mouffe and Daguerreotype, which were providentially screened last week, and I hope you all have seen them. Finally, I conclude with Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse deux ans après, the sequel of the film made by Agnès Varda in 2002. So, if we consider the title of the film, we get the first hint to define Agnès Varda as a gleaner of images and sounds. It is, in fact, Varda, the first who defines herself as a gleaner. She is La Glaneuse of the title, as alluded by the English title, The Gleaners and I. The lack of specification for masculine and feminine terms in the English language made it impossible to literally translate La Glaneuse, the woman gleaner. The replacement of the term La Glaneuse with I produces the effect of losing the sense of indeterminacy of La Glaneuse, anonymous gleaner among the other gleaners. And at the same time, it puts the first person of the director in the foreground. The German title, Die Sammler und die Sammlerin, maintains this sense of ambiguity and anonymity of La Glaneuse. Although, as Vince has already said, gleaner is translated with Sammler instead of the more accurate term Ehrenleser. This terminological consideration leads to the question, who are exactly gleaners? This is the question that Agnès Varda addresses in the film, putting the focus on the figure of the gleaners in French society and culture of the past and the present. In the historical tradition, gleaners are people who glean in the fields what is left after the harvest: grains, wheat, cereals, potatoes. As the art expert Varda recollects, the motif of gleaners was particularly present in the realist tradition of French painting during the second half of the 19th century. Varda refers not only to the most famous painting, Des Glaneuses, made by François Millet in 1857, but also to the work of Jules Breton, who explored the theme of, in various paintings, such as Les Glaneuses in 1854 and Les Rappels des Glaneuses in 1859, which you can see here. As we can infer from painting iconography, in the 19th century, gleaning was a collective activity. It involved peasant women and children gleaning grains and wheat in the fields, usually before the sunrise or after the sunset. Starting from this pictorial suggestion, Varda asks herself, who are the gleaners of the present days? This is the input for the quest of the film, which takes the form of, which takes forms as a documentary road movie. Agnès Varda travels and wanders through French countryside and cities in search of contemporary gleaners. The director observes that the tradition of gleaning in fields is still present in the French countryside. It is practiced not only by poor people in need of food, but also by others moved by traditional habits or the ethic of saving the food refused by industrialized agriculture. In the present time, gleaning became also an urban activity. In the cities, poor people pick up scraps from the trash can or left in the marketplaces, food excluded or rejected over soon from the consuming circle. Other people pick up abandoned or unused objects and materials left in the waste and give them a second life in the form of art or craftsmanship. The protagonist that Agnès Varda encounters in her travel through countries and cities are very different: villagers, farmers, activists, artists, ecologists, clochards and vagabonds, Saint-Ouen-Illois, without roof and law, recalling another film made by Varda. All these people became protagonists in the narration of the film. Agnès Varda portrays each of them through direct interviews in front of the camera, in which they express their relation to the act of gleaning and their different motivation: necessity, common sense, ethic, passion, ecologism, activism, and artistic intent. The documentary becomes a reflection on waste and poverty in the Western societies, the societies of the over, overproduction, overconsumption, and over waste. Since the beginning of her career, Agnès Varda showed her sensibility to the topic of poverty in our society, a topic that she tackles in different films, starting with L'Opéra Mouffe. Varda's attention to the act of gleaning regards not only its social and economic meaning as a way to actively resist against the consumer society. She is interested in gleaning in first person. She considers herself a gleaner. To make the point clear, in the film, in a film scene, Agnès Varda poses near the painting La Glaneuse by Jules Breton, assuming the same pose of the painted gleaner. In this scene, as well as in other moments in the film, Varda defines her work as gleaning with the camera and suggests the analogy between her work as a filmmaker and the act of gleaning. In an interview with Andrea Meyer in 2009, Varda explains, I quote, "It is true that filming, especially a documentary, is gleaning. Because you pick what you find, you bend, you go around, you are curious, you try to find out where are things. End quote. The attitude of the gleaners shaped the cinematographic work behind this documentary. The director approached her inquiry, traveling from the north to the south of France, looking for contemporary gleaners, picking and selecting them, coming closer and talking to them, finally interviewing them in front of the camera. The narrative of the documentary is primarily determined by the encounter Varda makes in her travel. The gleaner analogy recalls another analogy, the one between the photographer and the rag picker, described by Susan Sontag in her essay on photography. I quote, "The photographer and the consumer of photographs follows in the footsteps of the rag picker, who was one of Baudelaire's favorite figures of the modern poet. Everything that the big city threw away, everything it lost, everything it despised, everything it crushed underfoot, he catalogues and collects. He sorts things out and makes a wise choice. He collects, like a miser guarding a treasure, the refuse which will assume the shape of useful of or gratifying objects between the jaws of the goodness of industry." End quote. To glean, to gather, to pick, to collect, to conserve, to recuperate and to recycle. All these verbs define and describe perfectly the work of Agnès Varda. I maintain that the act of gleaning is a fruitful analogy to understand more generally Varda's artistic practice beside the film The Gleaners and I. To do so, I will consider Varda's art of gleaning in two ways. On one hand, in relation to her cinematographic practice, on the other, in relation to her cinematographic aesthetic style and poetic. As far as the cinematographic practice is concerned, Agnès Varda's art of gleaning is related to her craft-made approach to filmmaking, her attitude to carefully participate and follow all the phases from pre-production to distribution. Varda defines her approach to cinematographic work as cine-écriture. I quote, "I am doing what I believe is cine-écriture, what I always call cine-writing, which is not a screenplay, which is not only the narration words. It's choosing the subject, choosing the place, the season, the crew, choosing the shots, the place, the lens, the light. Choosing your attitude towards people, towards actors. Then choosing the editing, the music, choosing contemporary musicians. Choosing the tune of the mixing, choosing the publicity material, the press book, the poster. You know, it's a handmade work of filmmaking that I really believe, and I call that cine writing." End quote. But let us go behind the way in which Varda conceive, produce, and make the film. Can gleaning be found in Varda's film aesthetic, style, and poetic? The most immediate answer would be that gleaning, as an aesthetic instance, can be recognized in Varda's use of graphic matches and patchworks. In her films, there are often sequences in which different materials and sources are juxtaposed. Heterogeneous footage, paintings, set design, film excerpts, frames, mirrors, costumes, digression and allusions, souvenirs, thoughts. All these elements are gleaned together to compose each work, resulting in an eclectic style recognizable in many of her films. My purpose now is to go deeper and beyond this immediate sense of gleaning in Varda's work. In order to understand to what extent the her aesthetic and poetic approach changed and developed in Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, I found it useful to refer to l'opéra mouffe and Daguerreotype, which have more than one resonance with the film of tonight. These films, dated 1958 and 1975, also investigate with a documentary approach a particular slice of French society, including workmen, craftsmen, vagabonds, poor and emarginated people. A similar subject of representation is treated differently in the three films, especially in relation to the way these others are portrayed. What can be recognized is, in my opinion, a shift from an aesthetic approach based on gaze to an approach based on a gesture. In other words, I suggest to detect this shift from un certain regard, a certain gaze, echoing the name of the Cannes film selection section, to a certain gesture, namely the act of gleaning. L'opéra mouffe presents the inhabitants of the Mouffetard street, poor and old people, tramps, drunkards, the other humanity that wasn't usually portrayed on the big screen. Agnès Varda documents this humanity using an approach based on her gaze and her words. The filmic image is composed as a photographic portrait. The subjects are in the center, often looking at the camera. The composition is accurate, as well as the use of the depth of field. The framing attitude of the photographer Agnès Varda is here predominant. The observation of the camera is silent and detached. The subjects remain mute. The film sound consists in the song composed by Georges Delerue. The singing voice constructs the narration accompanying this section of portraits and attributing them a particular sense and meaning. In Daguerreotype, we find a similar poetic of the authorial gaze and voice. The film is structured through a series of portraits of the inhabitants of the Rue Daguerre, the street where also Varda lives. In the first part of the film, we can recognize a similar predominance of the photographic composition. The protagonists are framed as in photo portraits. The camera is silent and supposedly hidden, recording their daily life and their working activities. The narrating voiceover of Agnès Varda guides the storytelling from one portrait to the other. Only in the second third of the film, the protagonist speaks to the camera, answering to basic questions regarding their name, provenance, and dreams. The interviews occupy a limited space in the film. Varda still portrays the protagonist mainly through her photographic gaze and her voice recount. Agnès Varda defines this work as documentaire subjectif, a subjective documentary, that is a documentary that does not have the claim of objectivity and which is instead mightily connoted by the subjective narration. In L'Opéra Mouffe and Daguerreotype, the subjective narration takes form through her photographic gaze and voice recount. In Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, the poetic of the photographic gaze and authorial voice shifts towards a poetic of the gesture, of gleaning. As you will see in the film, on the level of the image, the precise and thoughtful frame composition is loosened. On the level of film sound, the narrating voiceover of Agnès Varda leaves space to the voices and narration of the people interviewed. The interviews occupy the most part of the film and forge its narrative structure and meaning. The authorial gaze and voice, although still present, is very attenuated here and substituted by a gleaning gesture towards reality and the others. If in L'Opéra Mouffe and Daguerreotype, the portraits of the others are drawn mainly through Varda's photographic gaze and narrating voice, in Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, the people interviewed propose their own portraits through their self-narration. The portraits of others became here the self-portraits made by the others themselves. This shift in the representation is also linked to a technological element, namely the use of the digital mini DV camera. The Cleaner and I is the first digital film made by Agnès Varda. It is interesting to point out that in 2000, when the film was shot, the use of digital cameras in film production was still pioneering. Most of the film directors still stuck by analog filming, reproaching the loss of quality in the image. At the time, digital cameras were used mainly by young or independent filmmakers who did not have the production means to afford shooting on film. The choice of the digital camera made by Varda in that particular context is therefore relevant, even more if we consider the past experience of the director as a photographer. This choice depended on production condition related to the particular kind of film Varda was composing. Varda admitted that she was able to realize this documentary thanks to the digital camera that allowed her to do the interviews on spot with a minimum of invasion in the private spaces of the Gleaners. It would certainly have been much more difficult and expensive to shoot this road movie documentary with an analog equipment. The digital camera allows the lightness, mobility, and freedom from the heavy cinema apparatus necessary in order to approach people in different environments and different social conditions. Making this choice, Varda reveals her openness and receptiveness to technological changes, her attitude to transform production constraints in aesthetic possibilities. Notably, Varda takes in this circumstance, for the first time, the camera on her hands. In the film, there are two cameras shooting. One is handled by an operator and the other one by Varda herself. She explores the new medium with curiosity and allows herself to lose the controlled photographic composition of each shot and frame, to play around with the hand camera, the focus, the flow, as you will see later in the film during the sequence of the dance of the landscape. I would like to show you now another scene that displays this attitude of the director. Could you please play clip one? Thank you. Also, Agnès Varda very often inserted elements of her autobiography in her films. This is one of the first, if not the first scene, where she makes an explicit self-portrait. She records her hands, her face, the mirror, the act of combing her hair. These shots recollect the long caressing pan on the hair, eyes, and skin of Jacques Demy in Jacques de Nantes. This leads us to the last point of this presentation, the self-portrait in relation to the portrait of the others. To discuss this point, I would like to show you another short scene from the film. Could you please play clip two? To film with one hand, my other hand. If we consider the figure of the caressing pan as pointed out by Vincent Sediger in his presentation, we will have here a self-caressing pan, which suggests the antinomy inherent to the act of caressing oneself, of caressing one hand with the other hand. the paradox of touching and being touched at the same time, of being the active and passive subject of the same action. Or, as in this scene, to be the representing and represented subject at the same time, as in the famous lithography Drawing Hands by Hescher. Varda asserts here, c'est toujours un autoportrait. It is always a self-portrait. This statement brings us to question the relation between the representing and the represented, between la glaneuse and the gleaners, between the eye and the other in the representation, between the self-portrait and the portrait of the others. This relation between the self and the other is a fil rouge to be found in Varda's work from the very beginning. Writing about La Pointe Courte, her first film, Varda states, I quote, un autre sujet me concernait, la non-correspondance du mode de pensée personnel au mode de pensée collectif. Les je et les nous ne s'entendaient pas. Quand je devenais un autre, les nous restaient massifs et engagés. I translate roughly. Another subject concerned me, the non-correspondence between the personal and the collective way of thinking. The I and the we did not understand each other. When the I became another, the we remained solid and engaged. This reflection leaves the open questions. Where does the auto-representation end and the representation of the other begin? Can the art of gleaning be intended also as the capacity to find herself portrayed in the portraits of the others, to glean pieces of the self among the others in the others? I leave you with this question before the screening and make just a final remark. To conclude, I briefly refer to the sequel of the film, Deux ans après, The Gleaners and I 2 years later. It should be noted that Le Glaneur et la Glaneuse had an unexpected success and resonance. It was distributed internationally and won festival prizes in Montreal and Chicago, as well as critique prizes in France and the USA. 2 years later, Varda decided to make Deux ans après, in which she raises the question, what are the leftovers of a film? What is the effect of a film for the ones who made it and for the spectators? What is left of a film? In the sequel, she returns to talk to some of the protagonists of the first film, but she also discovers new gleaners. This time, she does not look for the gleaners, but the gleaners look for her, sending her letters and evidences of their way of gleaning after having seen the first film. I would like to conclude with this scene from Deux ans après, in which the relation between the autoportrait and the portrait of the others is interestingly put into question by one protagonist of The Gleaner and I. And I ask to please play the clip 3. Okay, with this clip I end my presentation. Thank you for listening and enjoy the film.
Ja, thank you very much. Dankeschön für den Vortrag. Wir machen jetzt eine kleine Pause von circa 15 Minuten. Das Filmcafé hat noch geöffnet oben. Durch den Gong signalisieren wir dann, dass es gleich weitergeht und dann geht's mit dem Film los. Ja, bitte begrüßen Sie nochmal Sonja Campanini und Vincent Sediger. Herzlichen Applaus.
Ja, warten wir gleich noch. ganz kurz. Ja, vielen Dank erst nochmal für den sehr schönen Vortrag. Ich möchte vielleicht einsteigen mit dieser Einstellung am Anfang, die ja auch natürlich nicht von ungefähr am Anfang zu sehen ist, wo die Agnes Varda vor diesem Hintergrund mit dem Tuch neben dem Bild mit der Glaneuse zu sehen ist und dann die Garbe fallen lässt und die Kamera hochhält. Da geht es ja darum zu sagen, dass also die Arbeit mit der Kamera ist wie die Tätigkeit der Glaneuse. Und du hast ja in deinem Vortrag auch davon gesprochen, dass sie dass es der erste Film ist, den sie mit Digitalkamera dreht und dass sie eben eigentlich immer sich in gewisser Weise anpasst an die neuen technischen Gegebenheiten und die dann auch optimal ausnutzt. Als sie hier war, haben wir auch mit ihr gesprochen und unter anderem über 3D gesprochen. Da hat sie gesagt, das mache ich jetzt nicht mehr mit. Dafür bin ich zu alt, das ist zu anstrengend. Aber den Übergang zu Digitalvideo hat sie noch mitgemacht und das ist ja so eine Anpassung, eine neue Technik, wo dann plötzlich nochmal das, was sie eigentlich immer schon machen wollte, auf eine andere Art möglich wird. Nicht? Vielleicht kannst du dazu noch etwas sagen.
Ja, auf Englisch.
As you wish. Not a problem.
Yes. So, it is quite interesting how she uses the technology here. And what I try to also understand in my presentation was to see how she approaches the digital technology differently from the analog one, and if there is a technological factor behind an aesthetic choice or not. And to me, or for my opinion, there are some aesthetic choices that I think she wouldn't have been done before with analog technology, and she almost allows herself to play a lot more with the camera with digital technology. I mean, also the material of the documentary, this film per se, it's something that calls for this kind of action, of aesthetic and action. Mm. So I don't know to what extent it was just a play with the technology, or it was really a way to adjust herself to the material she was trying to describe and the people she was approaching. So maybe I also think it depends really also on the way she poses herself in relation to the other people she interviews here, and the fact that these people comes from maybe different social environments, and she wouldn't probably have been at ease if she had a big camera, or if she had in this kind of lightness in the possibility of filming these people without being too intrusive.
Mm. Also, da fällt mir gerade noch was dazu ein, diesen Gedanken aufzugreifen. Es gibt ja in dem Film drin, in der Mitte, fast so wie eine Mise en Abîme, einen weggeworfenen Film. Nämlich diese Geschichte von den jungen Obdachlosen, die den Supermarkt vandalisieren. Und das hat sie in der Zeitung gelesen und hat gesehen, das ist eigentlich eine Geschichte, die mich betrifft, das sind Glaneur und Glaneuse und da fahre ich jetzt mal hin und spreche mit denen. Und dann sagt sie ja sehr bald, die haben alle genau das gemacht, was von ihnen erwartet wurde, und die waren alle in einem kognitiven Loop drin und da gab es eigentlich gar nichts zu entdecken. Und sie ist ja ganz freundlich mit diesen Leuten, aber sie wirft den Film eigentlich weg. Also sie sagt, ich zeige euch jetzt ein paar Ausschnitte daraus und daraus hätte man vielleicht einen Film machen können. Aber das interessiert mich nicht und das ist eine doppelte Aussage, wie mir scheint. Einerseits muss, damit es sich lohnt, muss es eine Entdeckung sein, also muss irgendwas rauskommen, was neu ist. Und die Leute, mit denen sie spricht, müssen was gefunden haben, das sie auch interessiert. Und das andere ist, wenn man sich vorstellt, wie das gelaufen wäre mit herkömmlicher Technik, dann wäre sie da hingefahren mit einer 16mm Kamera und das hätte viel Geld gekostet, sie hätte dieses Material geschossen und gedreht und dann vielleicht doch verwendet und den schlechten Film gemacht. Mhm. Und eine der Möglichkeiten der Digitaltechnologie, die sie ja auch darstellt, ist, dass man drehen und wegschmeißen kann. Und diesen ganzen Film eigentlich wegschmeißen kann.
Yeah. Also which also relates to the topic of waste. Yeah. And I found it also nicely that she puts this sequence of the dance of the landscape, which is something that normally would be thrown away, and she kind of recycle it and give it a sort of possibility to become a film. Scene. So like also this play with what is waste in cinema, so what is what is the concept of waste in cinema or in normal cinema.
Ja, also vielleicht dazu noch was allerletztes. Ein Thema, das ihr durch den ganzen Film verfolgt, sind die künstlerischen Darstellungen der Glaneus aus dem 19. Jahrhundert. Und es ist ja interessant, die Geografie des Aufsuchens dieses Motivs sich nochmal zu vergegenwärtigen. Das ist erst der Dictionnaire Larousse, also man sieht die gebundenen Rücken des Dictionnaire und dann schaut sie da drin, da gibt das Verzeichnis Mie und der andere, wie heißt er nochmal, Kunsthistoriker. Ja, genau. Und nächste Station, Musée d'Orsay, in der Mitte von Paris, das große Museum der Kunst des 19. Jahrhunderts. Und dann geht es raus in die Provinz. Mhm. Nicht? Und immer tiefer. Und am Ende ist sie da in diesem Museum, muss man auf der Landkarte ganz genau hinschauen, um zu finden, wo das ist. Und die haben dieses offensichtlich nicht sachkundig unterhaltene Lager mit den Bildern und da muss viel weggeschafft werden, damit das Ding rauskommt. Und das ist ja auch nochmal eine Glanerie, wenn man so will.
And exactly this movement from Paris, from the center to these many provinces in France, this is also part of gleaning something that is usually considered leftover by normal cinema in France.
Es geht auch um die Inversion der kulturellen Hierarchien der französischen Kulturpolitik. Haben wir Fragen aus dem Publikum?
Oder dann geben Sie mir ein Zeichen und dann komme ich zu Ihnen.
Kalani, please.
Yeah, just to pick up on this topic of preservation and pulling things out of the archive. I was wondering in that last scene, and maybe in the first scene when people go into the museum and they see a painting and they take a photo of it, and she's working at this very important time of, I don't know, you know, digitization and different concepts about how images circulate. And it seems to me that she's positing an idea maybe of also not just preserving, but archiving something, that also gleaning images, that what she's doing is not just a way of taking something for myself, taking potatoes for myself, but putting things back into circulation and therefore maybe positing this idea of preservation, like along the lines of what Giovanna Fossati says about it's not just keeping something safe, but you have to show it again in order for it to really live. Do you think, or could you say something about what she's doing with not just waste, but images that are in museums, in archives?
I would say first something, because I just thought about it. Actually, what she also, with this film, she began also to approach installation work, and the heart-shaped potatoes that she founds here become the first installation she made for the Biennale. And she also, I think she's really into kind of recycling things of our work in future works. And this is a general trait. And regarding what she really does with archival material, do you mean like not her previous work, but generally with work of other or with archival?
Or if she's positing an idea of image retrieval here that's happening not just in her mentioning catalogs, and then showing us, you know, a filmic version of that catalog, or a filmic version of this dictionary entry, or a filmic version mm-hmm. of this painting that's taken out of the archive and put back into the storm from, mm-hmm. you know, which it actually portrays. And people taking photographs in these museums that are not very accessible and then putting them back into circulation. If there's also some larger commentary here about, you know, images circulating and being preserved, and also the importance of, like, image gleaning maybe for a new concept of archival theory.
I don't know, I mean, how much she would be really interested in conceiving this collecting and archiving things for the future. I think she's almost more interested in circulating in the present. So, like, really putting or throwing things out now. And yeah, personally she does care about her films, but I don't know if I mean, she's interested in art generally, and also in the way people now relate to her art generally. And she always has or at least we have seen maybe how she is used to film paintings, and also like in an unusual way. I liked very much how she also filmed this triptych of the condemnation and like she's really playing with a way of filming and letting art be seen again now, but I think it's more for the now than for the future. I'm not sure about it, to say.
I'm tempted to add a little something. I mean, there's a constant preoccupation with artworks and art postcards. In she's a massive collector of art postcards. And she also has a very keen understanding of the composition of important art collections. I mean, the most memorable moment when she received the Beckmann Prize here was that she started to tell the mayor of Frankfurt about the collection of the Städel Museum, which she knows because she's been here, and she's, you know, she has sort of a mind map of what painting is where. And then she went to the museum and went looking for the Van der Weyden, and then it was on loan, so it was a problem. But I think it's probably interesting to think of it against the backdrop of something like Malraux's idea of the imaginary museum, which is very much tied to photographic reproduction of art and the circulation mm-hmm. of art in the interest of education. And when she started making films in the 50s, that was one of the guiding concepts around, and all the art documentaries, of which she made several, were sort of inspired by the Malraux idea, but she transforms it into something new, I would mm-hmm. think.
And just to add a short autobiographical note, she took this passion for reproduction of fine art and paintings from her mother, who started to study arts when she was like 50 or something like that. And she has this, she talks in some interviews about these things of collecting postcards. And as you've seen in the film, she also buy like the same postcard twice, three times. So it's, I think it's something really also to maybe give like reevaluate also the reproduction of art, and not just the museum experience. It's, but yeah, I don't know how much this enters in our poetic.
Okay. Maybe just to add to this, I'm interested in hearing, let's say, now if to move from Les Glaneuses to Les Glaneux to La Glaneuse, to the I, and to hear if I kept thinking as I'm watching the film and listening to what you said and thinking and listening to what she says in the film, is she really a gleaner of images? Is she gleaning in the way that they're gleaning? What's the connection between then gleaning and her other project that she makes a big case for in the film, which is self-portrait, and that she filming one hand with the other, which is a kind of look at the self that sees the self already as othered. As she says, I don't recognize it. It's an animal. It's no longer me. So I just would be interested to hear. I'd like to hear you think through that more, or if you have thoughts about the connection now between gleaning images, if that's what she's really doing, and self-portraiture.
So I can first tell how she justified her self-portrait here in this film. She said that since she was speaking with these people about these subjects that often also are very delicate in some ways, and since these people were revealing so much of their life in a way, she felt the need to also disclose herself in her weaknesses, and that's why she decided to show her aging and to participate to this disclosing oneself in front of the others. So this is the official answer. And how I see it, I mean, it's kind of difficult because, as I said in the presentation, she's not really dissolving here, or her voice is still present, her way of telling and things is still present, her gaze in a way is still present. But what I think that also in comparison to L'Opéra Mouffe and Daguerreotype, here she really step a little bit behind and like try to really make at least, I mean, I think most of the more heavy and important things that are said in this film are not said by Varda herself, but are said by the people she interviews. So, I mean, she presented the material. She's always there. She is the fil rouge between this material. But what I believe is that she stepped back a little bit from being really the maître, the master of everything, and also leave space and time to the people, which also means, for instance, to maybe not care too much about the photographic composition, about the optimal sound. There are some scenes here which show like images out of focus, images like there is a sort of not very well done, filmic composition. So I'm just, and since we know that she is a perfectionist and she did that very also perfectly in previous documentaries and films, one can ask oneself if she stepped back here. So in other words, I mean, sometimes you could, from the image point of view, you could always think that this is a movie made in a style, in a fairly common documentary style, in a fairly common, also maybe television documentary style. So if you keep the voice, her voice away and her scenes away, if you just see how the interviews are done, how the, so yeah, am I clear at this point? Do you, can, was that the question? Well, yeah.
I would just say, I think that's a really interesting perspective to draw attention to the compositional laxity in this film. I'm not so sure that I buy the fact that she stepped back. I find her incredibly present in the film, and I'm just not sure what I think about it. On the one hand, I think it's fantastic to not just give us this portrait of these people and leave it at that, to attempt to find some connection with her own practice. I'm just questioning, just to be honest and just straightforward, I'm just really questioning and wondering whether she takes too much away from the specificity of their situations in her. I think she genuinely cares for these people, is really interested, is like a good person, but I think that she may, in her staging of herself and her need to find, to see herself also as a gleaner, that she may risk overgeneralizing and missing so many aspects of her own practice that make her not a gleaner.
I know. I mean, I understand. Like, and as I said, it's. I don't know how far really we can go with this metaphor of gleaning. Although as you said, I can genuinely see her trying to glean from reality, or at least she does that in a way that at least is not too much dramatic, not too much pathetic. Like, probably she also has to put so much herself in the film in order not to be either activist documentary about waste or a documentary about vagabonds and clochards. So I think this is also a way to try to balance that with her presence in the film. I don't know how, like, although I still think that in a way gleaning function as a metaphor also for previous works she made. So it's kind of as an attitude, generally speaking. But I understand your point.
Yeah. Bettina.
Das waren ja schon zum Teil die Antworten genau auf die Frage, die ich auch stellen wollte. Aber mir schien das, dass diese Anverwandlung oder diese Komplizenschaft, von der du gesprochen hast mit den Cleaners, ganz stark funktioniert auch über Tempo und Rhythmus. Es gab so eine wohltuende Diskrepanz zwischen dem, was man normalerweise zu sammeln vielleicht etwas romantisierend assoziiert von sich Zeit nehmen und Blick schweifen lassen und Ruhe und Dauer. Und dagegen hat sie ja so einen ganz flotten, frechen Rhythmus gesetzt, den ich sehr angenehm fand und dem auf der visuellen Ebene vielleicht entsprechen würde. Vielleicht kann man es so übersetzen als Unterschied von Einsammeln und Sammeln. Einsammeln passiert mehr oder weniger auch so routinemäßig und dem entspreche so ein Blick aus dem Augenwinkel, während man beim Sammeln fokussiert. Mhm. Und ich finde, da liegt so ein bisschen die Verwandtschaft auch zu den Personen, die sie porträtiert. Und das ist genau das, trifft dann auch genau den Punkt, vielleicht den Marc angesprochen hat. Das kann nur funktionieren natürlich, wenn da eine unglaubliche Routine und Erfahrung dahinter steckt. Sonst funktioniert dieser Augenwinkelblick, dieser periphere Blick nicht, den man beim Einsammeln so mitnimmt. Und das porträtiert sie, finde ich, auch genau in den Vorgängen, die sie da beschreibt. Und darin ist sie natürlich auch absolut professionell und gar nicht zurückgehend. Ja. Und trotzdem entsteht dabei, finde ich, eine absolut plausible Komplizenschaft. So. Mhm. Durch Rhythmus, durch Tempo, durch dieses etwas Flüchtigere.
Ja, thank you, Bettina.
Ja. Sie interessiert sich ja auch immer für die Technik der Gleaners. Also sie fragt, wie die das machen und erklärt die spezifischen Techniken. Sie sagt, es gibt auch einen Moment, der mir sehr bedeutsam schien, wo sie sagt, j'aime filmer les rochers. Und das heißt, es ist ein Vergnügen, es ist ein Spaß und für sie ist das Cleaning eine ästhetische und künstlerische Tätigkeit. Und es ist auch eine Könnerschaft, genau. Und das unterscheidet sie natürlich von den anderen Cleaners. Also es ist ja, der Film offeriert ja auch eine Typologie. Und es geht ja auch immer um diese Unterscheidung, das Pflücken und das Auflesen. Nicht? Le Grappillage und le Glanage. Also es geht schon auch um technische Fragen und das wird immer wieder reflektiert. Ferino hat das Mikrofon, danach ist Ihnen dran.
Ja, ich wollte...
Marc will dann auch noch was sagen.
Pick ich das jetzt mal auf, oder nehme das mal auf, was du gerade gesagt hast, Vincent, dass ich schon glaube, dass sie auch eine Typologie hat von Gleanern, dass man sozusagen sehen kann, die Leute, die eher gezwungen sind, das zu tun, die sich eine Nische getan haben, die das aus Protest tun. Und sie entkommt natürlich nicht, das glaube ich schon, was du sagst, Marc, dass sie diesem Risiko, sich anzubiedern an eine prekäre Situation, in der sie eigentlich nicht ist. Das ist richtig. Aber ich finde schon, dadurch, dass sie so eine Typologie oder so ein Typologie ist vielleicht zu viel gesagt, aber so ein Set irgendwie aufmacht, könnte man mal vielleicht versuchen, das Ganze mit dem Begriff von Found Footage zu beschreiben, den man sozusagen einmal auf die Filmebene beziehen kann, und zwar nicht nur auf Filmmaterial oder Bildmaterial. Zum Beispiel, ich finde diese Herzkartoffel, benutzt sie wie Found Footage eigentlich. Und man kann Found Footage auch im metaphorischen Sinne nehmen und das dann sozusagen rückbeziehen auf Nahrungssammeln, wo man eher den Gebrauchswert oder sowas hat.
Found Footage.
Ja.
Die Herzkartoffel fand ich total gut. Found
Food. Ja, kann man ja machen mit Found Footage.
You want to answer the question?
I think it was a comment.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. Okay.
Also ich wollte eigentlich da nochmal anschließen, was eben gesagt wurde zu den, dass sie sich natürlich irgendwie als Gleaner auch an diese diese Techniken irgendwie annähert. Und da scheint mir doch auch irgendwie was zu sein, was in anderen Filmen auch immer wieder vorkommt, nämlich diese Frage nach der Zeit, also Verschränkung von Zeitebenen. Und es gab ja eine Gleanerin in dem Film, die das richtig konnte. Das war diese Bauersfrau am Anfang mit der Schürze. Die hat, also diese Handbewegung, das kam ja auch in dem Vortrag vor mit den Gesten. Das war eine Geste wie aus dem Gemälde von Millet. Das war also nochmal so ein Rückbezug, wo in der Geste plötzlich das Gemälde tatsächlich lebendig wird, weil die das drauf hat, also die kann es. So wie die anderen das nicht gemacht haben, das nicht, dass sie das nicht können, aber das war jemand, der offensichtlich große Flächen irgendwie abgegrast hat. Und da wäre jetzt meine Frage einfach, wie das, also was mir auffällt, ist, dass sie ja auch die Gemälde und so einsetzt, um sie zu aktualisieren, aber um sich und auch das, was sie zeigt, wieder irgendwie in der Zeit zurückzubinden und so. Und das sind ja immer so recht komplizierte Strukturen, was vielleicht auch mit dem ein bisschen zu tun hat, was Marc gesagt hat. Also warum bindet sie sich da so ein? Ihr Altern, dann auch Rembrandt, wo natürlich das Selbstporträt auch immer an eine bestimmte Zeit gebunden ist. Also sie sucht sich da eins aus, da ist er so, weiß ich nicht, mittelalt, aber es gibt ja aus jedem Alter irgendwie was. Also wo auch wieder diese Zeitdimension drin ist.
Und die Frage ist, welche, also was für
Strategien oder so, oder war jetzt einfach, also vor allem war es diese Beobachtung, dass da wirklich eine ist, die das, also wo das so auflebt, das ist mir so aufgefallen. Mhm. Das scheint sie ja öfter auch zu machen.
Yes, I think that, I mean, what she tries to do, also recalling this painting tradition of the gleaners, and quasi building this analogy between the gleaners of the 19th century and the gleaners of today, is also to build a sort, I mean, of connection, and in a way also saying that maybe that there isn't much difference between this person, especially the ones who are gleaning in the countries, and like the way they approach gleaning is some of them also say it's just they do it because they did it as a child, and it was normally to think that if things are left on the ground and are not used by the people who own these fields, they can and should be useful for other people. So, and also to try to maybe put into question the notion of progress in a way, like just to say, okay, let's look at this film. These are portraits of French people in 2000. And it's also interesting to note, like, we are way before the economic crisis in Europe and so on. So it was a time in which maybe talking about poor people in our countries was not so habitual, common. And so that's why I think she also very gently, in a way, make a statement, like, you see these people and they do something that was done 200, 150 years ago, and it's still there. And on the other hand, we have the contraposition to the big cities where a lot of food is waste. And I don't know, I mean, I can see this time portrait, this representation of how time really acts on society very critically from her standpoint. But yeah.
Mark. In the spirit of the typology, if we think of the film as providing, that's one of the things I thought was very interesting. The film provides us, like, there's gleaning, there's what, ripé or something. There's mm-hmm. so ripié?
Rapié.
So where the gleaning, you bend over, we get the posture of gleaning, and it's stooped over, picking from the ground. The rapié, like picking from above. And Varda, so then if we're thinking of gleaning as a cinematic technique, well, what does that then mean? That's I guess what I just wanted to leave us, or not leave us, I mean, I want to leave at least my contribution to the discussion. We can continue, but because I'm just thinking, I think your example, Sonia, I thought was really quite wonderful about the wasted image. This kind of, I didn't particularly like that sequence, but I thought it was a very convincing example of wasted footage. The dancing lens cap, and she like gleans from herself, from her own, like, waste product for her film, but I she doesn't stoop. She says she stoops. Maybe she did, but I didn't see a shot that indicated stooping. Gleaners seem to be locally organized. She draws attention to her ability to travel to Japan and come back. So I'm just wondering if that's what I guess I would have liked her to reflect more on if she's saying I'm gleaning too, then I think she needs to reflect more on the actual technique, the technological, the style, the all the different aspects of gleaning that she's so careful to draw out in the people she interviews. I think that we would need to think about that in relation to cinematic practice as well. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm trying to mm-hmm. reflect on.
Yeah. How do you imagine a more gleaning?
Like a gleaninger, more a gleaned, a better gleaned film? I don't know.
No, because I mean I really understand your doubts, but it's I also try to understand it from the production, let's say, side. And I don't know, yeah, what should she have done?
What she should have done. I mean, I'm not here to tell her what she should have done, but what she should have done is learned from her gleaners.
She should have not only learned from her gleaners to reflect on herself, but learned from her gleaners to question her assumption that she does the same thing that they do. And thereby attempt to try to specify what it is she does that is not like what they do, as a way of helping us understand ways that one can connect mm-hmm. across differences, but be respectful of the differences and specificities of each mm-hmm. of the others, so to speak.
Yes. On the other hand, I think like she probably worked this gleaning metaphor out as the only way to justify she being doing this film, because I mean maybe it's naive but she play as a naive, this is not over questioned or self criticized. And but you have seen also in the scene of Deux Ans Après as the alphabetisateur actually very like said her that her self portrait was not necessary or he didn't like it. I mean, he was in a way deconstructing the whole structure of the previous film, and she says to the like, okay, it's nice to hear the opinions of everybody, but I mean I understand your point, but on the other hand I ask myself what would have been another way to do that without being politicized or dramatizing the material, or just being, because what I think is nice in this film is that, I mean, this is, I heard people laughing. So I think this was actually the good thing.
May I interject for just a second? Because it's a fascinating question. I just want to bring up something that Sonia discussed in her talk, and which is in a way contained in the quote that used, where she talks about je comme autre et nous comme solide, where she says I am another. I mean, it's the Rambo quote, but that's part of what she explores. And then she said, but the new, the us, that's the solid thing. That's mm-hmm. that's where I sort of find myself. And what I would ask you, Mark, is it really, is she really not asking that question? Because, I mean, one of the great things of Sonia's talk was that she started off with the three posters and the translation problem. And the English translation of the title, which is Gleaners in the Eye, which is an entirely different statement from Les Glaneurs et la Glaneuse, because the identity of the Glaneuse is not at all clear. It could be the painting of La Glaneuse, and that's how the film starts off, where she posits herself right next to it. And I think you could construct a reading where she says, you know, she looks at this painting and asks herself, is that me? You know, that's the self-portrait in the other, of the other, through the other problem. And part of that figure of the self-portrait of the other, I think, and that's part of what Sonia said, is that, that there's a méconnaissance. It's not you. It will never be you. And it's about that not being you, the je est un autre structure, that I think that she reflects in that film. So I think that it's entirely possible to construct a reading where she actually uses the typology to figure out whether or not she really is a gleaner. And what it is that sort of attracts her to that painting. So, sorry, Philipp. Altes hermeneutisches Prinzip, den Text stark machen.
Warte, jetzt habe ich, na gut, sorry, ich bin raus. Nee, nur ganz kurz, mich hat am Ende, das ist jetzt aber ein kleiner Themenwechsel, total gestört, dass sie irgendwie, sie hat so viele spannende Leute kennengelernt und dann der einzige, von dem sie irgendwie, oder der, von dem sie am meisten beeindruckt war, war der mit Master's Degree in Biologie und konnte erzählen, welche Vitamine in Petersilie drin sind. Also ernsthaft, ja. So. Was für eine Bildungsaura.
I mean, I think what, because, for instance, the character of the truck driver in the beginning, this is like a cliché. So a truck driver who drink too much because he has to work too many hours, and then he is caught by the police. He has to lose his job, and then his wife, and then his family. So maybe what was interesting in this character was that actually he could have had another occupation. He could have, like, it seems that he, and you can see that also in the second part of the film, he actually chose that in a way. And this is not just because, I mean, he could have also lost his job and maybe, but also the fact that, how he talks about gleaning and eating from the market, and how he also, I think she saw in him a controversial aspect in what, like, or something that wasn't a cliché in a way, or maybe because, which is maybe what struck, because as it, also most of the audience was struck by this character much more than by the others. Maybe because he is, although he could have had another life, he chose this life and also wanted to volunteer, and in a way, I don't know, I'm also in a way fascinated by this character because what the way he teaches also. So, I mean, I can understand why she was fascinating also by this character, and not just because he has a master's degree in biology, but because he talks about gleaning the food as a biologist, and like he doesn't really, I don't know, but maybe some other people had some feeling about this character, or yeah.
Ich kann diese Faszination auch verstehen, weil ich irgendwie das Gefühl hatte, alle anderen Charaktere, da habe ich das Gefühl, sie wissen, was sie da tun und sie wissen, warum sie das tun. Bei ihm habe ich nicht verstanden, warum er das tut. Also ich habe eher das Gefühl, dass er in irgendwas, weiß ich nicht, dass er eher in irgendwas reingefallen ist, als dass er es entschieden hat für die anderen. Deswegen war ich zum Beispiel fasziniert von ihm, aber nicht, weil er... Ich weiß es nicht. Ich glaube, also nach dem, also so wie ich Agnes war da wahrgenommen habe, glaube ich nicht, dass es die Bildungsaura ist. Weswegen sie fasziniert war von ihm. Aber er ist einfach ein Charakter, der, weiß ich nicht, der irgendeine vielschichtige Ebenen hat. So, irgendeinen Subtext, den ich auch noch nicht so richtig durchblicke. So. Maybe. That's another answer.
You should watch the Deux Ans Après. It's really nice.
Ja, ich bin versucht zu sagen, es gibt ein Buch, das noch nicht geschrieben wurde und mal geschrieben werden müsste. The Mystique, The French Mystique of Public Education. Also man, das ist nochmal eine dritte Lesart neben diesen beiden, nicht? Also du sagst Classism und so. Aber ich glaube schon, dass das eine Rolle spielt, dass das ein Edukateur ist, der aus dem System ausgetreten ist und da soziale Mobilität generieren will und das gewissermaßen als Bettelmönch macht. Und das ist schon eine Beschwörung einer bestimmten republikanischen Idee von sozialer Mobilität durch Bildung. Und ich glaube schon, dass man darüber nachdenken kann, weshalb sie ausgerechnet den als ihren größten Fund betrachtet und ans Ende des Films setzt. Mark Siegel again.
I look to Urs. I don't want to do the Mark Siegel show.
It's a good show, though. It's a good show.
I just want to
let someone continue dance.
What Vincent said. I mean, thinking her quote, the I and the other, I actually think that... For me, what works most successfully in terms of her establishing her own subjectivity, herself as other, and thereby attempting to generate a we, if you think of the quote in that way, is when she focuses on her aging, but not when she focuses on herself as Glenure. that's sort of okay. What I, because I feel like that's a point where she is reflecting on othering and on the cinematic, the medial production of the self as other, that seems to open up a space for connection that for me sometimes, and I don't know, I'm sort of not sure, I'm trying out these ideas, but that for me sometimes in the kind of, I didn't, in other ways, I didn't find her questioning herself as a glaneuse. I don't remember that. I found it more of a kind of pretty confident or playful but confident connection. Whereas the age issue, that to me seemed very, very making herself vulnerable, very similar to her as pregnant woman filming in L'Opéra Mouffe. Und so weiter. Yeah, so
which is, by the way, the teacher guy reacts to the age issue and not to the gleaning.
Yeah, exactly. I know. That's why I wanted to differentiate myself from the teacher guy, despite his wonderful work in alternative education.
Yeah. I mean, maybe the using the gleaning thing is an easier way to build this connection for the broad audience, and at the same time she also like very clearly make a statement about aging, and this is also a way, but I mean, as the teacher said, all the people will age. So this is not something unusual. What is unusual is maybe leaving the life before in another way or trying to do so. So I don't know, but maybe, yeah, other people could say the opposite. And yeah, it's always, I mean, this is exactly the perfect example of how we see ourselves in the represented. So how much of ourself there is in the interpretation of something. So maybe you want to see the aging and other people want to see the gleaning.
Okay, one last thing.
Because I think what you mentioned about Marot might be interesting in this context. The problem with Marot's imaginary museum is that the good thing is that you can compare different images from different areas, different periods in time. But the problem always is, and he's been criticized for that, is that of overgeneralization and of decontextualization. And I think that's pretty similar to what you found in this film, that she just has the glaneuse, whoever she is, if it's the painting or if it's her, and then she has different things that she arranges around this image, and she makes comparisons, and she finds interesting things, but the problem is that of decontextualization and over, or the danger of decontextualizing these images and of drawing conclusions that may.
I mean, just as a learned footnote, it's not that Malraux doesn't know that. Sure. He talks about it. I mean, that's like the Benjamin, that's what he takes from Benjamin. He says the intervention of the photographic technique completely alters the status of the art object. And the museum, once you start selling postcards, is no longer the same. You know?
It tells, he knows about it, but then he puts the Khmer sculpture and the Greek sculpture on opposite pages, and this argument is much stronger than what he... It's so obvious that there must be a connection, even if there is none.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I think we can continue that over a beer. Right.
Ja, dann sagen wir doch herzlichen Dank für den tollen Abend, Sonja Campanini, Vincent Hediger und Ihnen vielen Dank für die lebhafte Diskussion. Genau, und ich möchte auch schon mal ankündigen, im Juni geht es weiter, 2. Juni, und dann widmen wir uns nochmal einem anderen Thema von Agnes Wader, nämlich Los Angeles. Und wir werden auch einen ganz tollen Gast bei uns haben, Rita Gonzalez vom Los Angeles County Museum of Arts. Rita, sie wird dann Mür Mür vorstellen, und im ganzen Monat geht es auch so ein bisschen um Los Angeles und Agnes Wader. Also es lohnt sich wiederzukommen, bis bald und schönen Nachhauseweg. Tschüss.